Welcome to the Exploring Unschooling podcast. I'm Pam Larickia, unschooling mom and author, bringing you interviews, information, and inspiration about unschooling and living joyfully with your family. You can find the episode show notes, your free Exploring Unschooling ebook, and lots more information at livingjoyfully.ca. And here's the show. Hello, everyone. I'm Pam Larickia, and this is episode number 35 of the podcast. It's the 31st of August, 2016, as I record this intro. In this episode, I chat with Joe Isaac about how the conventional path to success, school to college to good office job, often loses its luster when we choose to embrace unschooling. The paradigm shifts we make often do include redefining our idea of success for our children and for ourselves. We have a great conversation about it all, and Joe has some really interesting experience to share. Around here, Lissy's visiting this week, and we're having tons of fun. Last night, we went to see Michael in his Medieval Times dinner and tournament show. We all yelled and cheered and ate with our hands and had a great time. My throat was quite raw last night. I may be biased, but I think Michael is an awesome squire. This week, I'd like to share a quote of Jo's from the show. She was referencing her son Kai's quieter time right now and said, "The problem with thinking of it as a cocoon phase implies we're all putting up with this cocoon phase and waiting for him to come out as a butterfly, and everything is going to be okay then at some point in the future." I feel like that's the same as what's wrong with the conventional idea of success. You're always looking down the road, waiting for some kind of ideal in the future, and missing what's happening right now. I thought that was such a great insight, that the conventional definition of success always has us looking at the future, always chasing that carrot, rather than appreciating today. That's a very cool thing to consider. And now, for many more things to consider, on to the interview. Hi, everyone. I'm Pam Larickia from livingjoyfully.ca, and today and tomorrow, I'm here with Joe Isaac. Hi, Joe.
Hi. Hi, Pam.
If you can tell by the accent, Joe is over in Australia right now. So that is why my lame tomorrow joke went. As by way of introduction, I really enjoyed reading Joe's unschooling perspective over the years, and I was really excited that she agreed to chat with me about how unschooling's take on how we define success can differ widely from the conventional one. So I've got a few questions for you, and let's get started. First, can you share with us a bit about you and your family and how you came to unschooling?
Sure, absolutely. So there's just the three of us. There's me, my husband Brett, and our son Kai, who is 10 now. And he has been always unschooled. We live near Melbourne, in Victoria, Australia. Since Kai was born, we've lived all over the place. He was born in Queensland. We moved to California, Colorado, Tasmania, and Adelaide, and now we live in Melbourne. So, I've decided we're not moving again for a really long time. We really like Melbourne. I don't love the winters, but on the whole, it's a pretty cool place, and there's lots of unschoolers here, so we're pretty happy. Brett and I met while we were doing our PhDs in Queensland. We're both zoologists, and he was working on lizards, and I was working on possums. And unschooling, yes. So how I came to unschooling is it's a long story. It's probably a long story for everybody. But I grew up in working class England, and I wasn't very good at school. I didn't do school very well. I didn't learn the way that school taught, and I was always behind, and it was a struggle. I left school at 16, and I failed all my GCSEs. And when I was around 20, I saw an interview with Caitlin Moran. She's a well-known British comic and writer, and she was about 16 at that point. And in the interview, she said she was homeschooled, and I had never, ever heard of such a thing and never didn't know anyone who was homeschooled. And I got really mad at my mom and said she should have homeschooled me. And at that point, I swore if I ever had children in the future that I would homeschool them. So that was when I first heard about homeschooling. 20 or so years later, I was a new mom and I was living in Queensland doing a postdoc and Kai was in daycare. And I still dreamed of homeschooling and I still had that in my head, but it was very difficult feeling like I would give up the career that I'd worked, you know, for 10 years in academia to get to. But as time went on, I wasn't really enjoying academia, and Brett got a postdoc in America for 2 years, and that was when I started homeschooling Kai. And a little bit before that, I was doing a nature writing online course, and one of the other participants mentioned Unschooling, and I went off and read all I could about it, and thought that that sounded like something that I would like to do. And when we moved to Boulder, and Brett, it was all part of the postdoc that Brett was doing, I found a large group of unschoolers there, and that was it. That was, then the rest was history. So that's how I found unschooling, and it was really cool at that point. And Kai was only three, to find a big group of unschoolers with older kids that we could learn from, and I could just see how amazing all these kids were. So that was really great, and I was very lucky to find that group.
Yeah, that's really cool. And all your travels too. Wow, that was cool to end up in a spot there.
Yeah, no, well, I don't know. Kai doesn't really agree with the whole traveling thing. He says, he said, when I'm grown up, I'm not traveling anywhere. So.
Brilliant.
But, yeah, we've had lots of very cool experiences and seen lots of places, so it's been really awesome. But, yeah, I certainly credit Boulder and Colorado with getting us off on the right foot with unschooling. So,
yeah, that's really great that you happened upon, you know, at a great age for Kai too.
Yeah.
And you got a big group with older kids and everything for yourself too.
Yeah. It was very cool. And yeah, I wish everybody could get that, but I know it's not possible everywhere. But yeah, we're very blessed to find the group.
That's awesome. I would love to hear a little bit more about Kai, what he's up to, what he's interested in right now, and how he's pursuing it, that kind of stuff.
So Kai, as I said, he's 10. He's in that cocoon phase that everybody talks about. I don't really like that term at all.
Yeah.
I've been trying to think of something new to call it, because it makes it sound like, you know, we're all putting up with the cocoon waiting for him to turn into this beautiful butterfly, but he's a beautiful cocoon. So
I know, yeah. It's hard to find a term that kind of describes it without having any expectations on it, right?
Yeah. And I read an article on it and the other day, but it was from a conventional point of view, but they actually said, you know, wait patiently and they'll turn into a butterfly. I'm like, well, what about So... he's super awesome right now, and so we're enjoying this phase and letting him cocoon away. His favourite place is home, and that's awesome. He is a really big gamer. He's playing a lot of Overwatch at the moment, which is a very cool game that he plays with his friends. He Skypes with friends in Canada every day. with Jody Lilly's son, who Jody did a podcast with you a while ago. And some other Canadian friends, so we're well versed on time differences between here and Canada. he's met some of these friends face to face. He was lucky enough to meet Jody's son when they came to Australia last year, which was really cool. Some of the friends he only knows online, but those friends are so, so important to him every day, and they are definitely his real friends. So, online friends are real friends and very important to him at the moment. It's really cool. We listen to them solving problems and working as a team to beat other teams, and they're just doing so much. They're so busy. So even though he's cocooning, he's busy in there. And the fact that he can game in real time and Skype with people on another hemisphere is very cool. So that's mostly what he's doing. That's most of his day. We also see local friends pretty regularly. As I said before, we're lucky enough to have a few radical unschooling families around Melbourne, and they're all the same tween kind of age, which is very cool. We have a weekly park day that we go to, and we go to the zoo and the wildlife park and museums. what else is Kai doing? He's reading Harry Potter. He just started The Chamber of Secrets. Likes dinosaurs and paleontology and anime, especially Naruto. So recently he started a dog walking service, which is very cool. And we're quite busy with that. We were quite astounded at the level of interest that we got for our dog walking service, and I had to quickly take the advert down, otherwise we'd have had no free time at all. So,
wow.
So we've got two dogs at the moment, and altogether we walk them 5 times a week. So we actually only get Mondays off from dog walking at the moment. I go with him, and so he's really enjoying that and spending time with the dogs because he really wants a dog, but we're not really in a position to get one at the moment. And he's earning quite a lot of money. So, yeah, it's a win-win all around. And, yeah, we really like the dogs are always really pleased to see us. Their owners are out all day and I guess they feel guilty. And so we feel like we're doing something good for the dogs and the owners, and they're very cute dogs. So yeah, that's pretty much what Kai's up to. Yeah.
That's cool. That's a cool way. Like you mentioned that he would like to have a dog, and this is a way that, you know, he can get that within the constraints that you have right now, that you can't actually own one, but what a cool way to hang out with a bunch of dogs.
Yeah. And I think it's really, cause we live in a rental, and the rental part of the agreement is no pets. So that's why we've got a dog at the moment. In the beginning he thought it might be a little bit too sad to look after a dog and not have his own dog, but he's finding that that's not actually true for him at the moment. He really does like hanging out with the dogs, and Sunday we did get to bring one of the dogs home for a few hours, so that was very cool. She slept on his bed and that was cool. And it's, you know, it's having a dog's a big responsibility, so it's good practice as well. So
yeah, no, that's awesome.
Yeah, so today we've got two dog walks. So Thursday's two dog walks.
And good exercise too.
Yeah, I'm getting a lot more exercise than normal.
I was hoping to ask you what the definition of success was that you grew up with, and where have you taken the idea of success since then?
Right, yes. We chatted a little bit about this before, and my background is probably a little bit different to a lot of people's idea of success. In Britain, when I grew up in the 70s and 80s in a working class family, I didn't know anyone who had been to college. Certainly no one from my school was expected to go to college. So the idea of success for me, I guess my parents just hoped I'd get a good job in an office, get married, and eventually we might be able to afford to buy a house. That was pretty much what most of my school friends have done. No one ever expected me to go to college, which was a good job because I did dismally at school. that idea, that standard of success was quite different to what most people have got in their head of school and college and career and good job. Yeah, so I left school at 16, and I did actually kind of head off in that direction. I left school at 16 and I worked in offices for a while, but I knew early on that wasn't really for me. I didn't really thrive in that atmosphere even. And in my head, even though I was really young, the idea of staying around my hometown for my whole life was just not something that I wanted to do. I worked as a typist when I was 16 and 17. One day my mum was on holiday, so she wasn't there to stop me. I just walked out and didn't go back to work. And in the meantime, in that week, I'd always wanted to work with animals. But because I wasn't very good at school, I'd kind of quit biology at 13, and school had pretty much told me that I was not smart enough to do anything in the sciences. But I managed to get a job at the local RSPCA as working in the kennels, and I worked there for on and off for about 5 years. And my passion for animals was always something that was underlying all my choices all along. I also really wanted to travel and get away from that hometown. So I went to New Zealand when I was 18 for 3 months, and I stopped in Australia on the way back and fell in love with Australia and spent the next year earning money back at the RSPCA to come back on a working holiday visa. And I did come back for a year, and then I spent the next 6 years traveling and working backwards and forwards here and there, all over the place. Traveling, I think, was probably the very start of my de-schooling, though of course I wouldn't have called it that because I wasn't doing it intentionally. But when I was traveling, I met lots of people on a gap year. So people who were probably more middle class than I was, and on the typical success trajectory, taking a year off uni before going back to get their degree. And while I was, I met these people, you know, and I was thinking, oh, well, if these people are smart enough to go to university, then I think maybe I am as well.
So, yeah.
I guess when I left school, I had a very, very low idea of my own intellect and what I could achieve academically, because I didn't achieve anything academically at school. But after years of traveling and doing most of it on my own and meeting people who were going to uni, I started to question that idea. And when I was around 25, I decided that I was going to go and study zoology. My love of animals had always been something that swayed my choices in what I wanted to do. And I'd written to Greenpeace and World Wildlife Fund and asked them if I could go and work for them and save the whales and the pandas. And they said, you need a degree in zoology. So, all right then, I'm going to get a degree in zoology. So I did. I enrolled in an adult education course back in my hometown, where I was willing to go there by then. And I did that for a year, and that would allow me to get into university, they said. So I did that course, and I really, really enjoyed it. It was a really great experience, and much to everyone's amazement, especially my dad at the time, I kind of aced that course and came out top of the class. So, and I got into the university of my choice, which was Aberdeen, which was as far away from my hometown in Britain as I could possibly get. So I went to the top of Scotland to do a degree in zoology the following year, and I got a grant, which was really great. Back to success. I kind of got off track there. So I guess for most people, then the following 10 years, I looked more like I was on the typical success trajectory. I did really well in my college course. I got a first class honours from Aberdeen. I worked as a research assistant for a few months, and then I got a scholarship to do a PhD in Australia, which I was very lucky to get.
Wow.
I got to study possums on a tropical island for 3.5 years. So my PhD was too much of a hardship. So that was pretty cool, especially after 4 years in Scotland. A tropical island was a very nice change.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I finally got my PhD when I was 35. And then a year later, I had Kai. So I had Kai just before my 36th birthday. And just after I had Kai, I was offered a 2-year postdoc back in Queensland. Those 2 years of doing the postdoc, I looked like your typical model of success, I guess. Had a PhD, one child, a happy marriage, and a good job. And my academic career looked pretty fancy. I had lots of publications, and I was schmoozing with the right people and all that kind of thing. I on the outside, I looked like a success. Those 2 years were really stressful.
They were really, yeah.
And really, I felt like they destroyed a part of my soul. It was, I'd always, wanted to save the animals and save the whales and all that kind of thing. And, I realized that being in academia, that wasn't going to happen. It's all just grant applications and writing papers and jumping through hoops, and your dreams of saving the animals kind of get pushed to the side out of sight, really. I was working on climate change and animal extinctions, but it all seemed very esoteric, like I wasn't really doing anything that had a tangible result on helping animals at that point. I also really struggled with having kind daycare and trying to juggle being the mother I wanted to be and then keep hold of my career. And so towards the end of the two-year position, I started looking at other options and wondered whether this whole homeschooling thing, I could do that. And I started, I did the freelance nature and writing science course. And that was where I found out about unschooling. And around that time, Brett got the position in America and my 2 years were up. So I quit academia, I guess, at that point. And I was happy to do so. And for Brett to take up the academic mantle at that end. So I've worked from home since then, writing. Brett's had two postdocs since then, and obviously we've moved a lot. We don't have a lot of money, and we've never owned our own house. We've never really been in a position to stay anywhere long enough to buy a house. And Brett's looking for a science job in Melbourne at the moment. Despite us both being highly educated, we're pretty poor and guess we don't really look much of a success at the moment either. But I don't think either one of us would change anything. I think that our experiences and all the places we've lived have just been amazing. And I've never regretted giving up my academic career. And I know our family is definitely happier now than if I were still trying to juggle a career and Kyla's in school and everybody was short on time and patience. So,
I'm just going to let you keep talking because that is just such a fascinating story.
I've been on all sides of the non-success and success spectrum, I guess. So, yeah, from leaving school and being the person that no one would expect to succeed, and then leaving university and being the person everybody thought would succeed. It's a pretty weird position to be in. I think I have a fairly unique view of success as a result, probably.
Yeah, no, that's why I loved when you gave me a little bit of a heads up ahead of time. I'm like, wow, this is awesome. Because that's what was fascinating, because in each situation, you were working against what you were being told, right? Yeah. You know, when you were in your teens, you know, there were no expectations on you to be able even to, you know, get into a college or university whatever. That was not in the picture.
I can't imagine what my teachers would say if I told them I had a PhD. They'd just fall over.
Yeah, no, that's so fascinating. And then you end up doing that and, you know, going through that whole process, doing very well at that, enjoying that piece at the time. And then when you came out of it, reevaluating again the path that was laid out for you again. So every time you're really in looking at the path that's kind of expected of you and saying, you know, does that work for me right now?
When I was writing about it and I was kind of like, wow, I've made all these choices, but I think that was it. All the choices that I made were, you know, am I happy right now? And if I'm not, what do I need to do to change that? Without thinking too far in the future, I quit my job and, you know, we didn't have as much money, but I was miserable in academia. So, you know, I would way rather be poor than miserable. I think they were just all choices at the time to do something that would make all of our lives better, I think. And that's, I guess, yeah, that making our lives better, that's success to me, I guess, or a version of it, a more important version of it.
Yeah. No, that's great. Speaking of choices a bit, my next question, I wanted to focus a bit on the shift to seeing college and university as a choice rather than often that kind of conventional fixed landmark on the path to success. and how that shift can be challenging for people. It can almost feel neglectful at first, you know, like, oh, I am going to fail my kids if I let them not hit that landmark, because that landmark is so ingrained for a lot of people anyway. Do you have you found that, like, that neglectful piece? Because I know at first it's like, oh, it felt like a pressure release, but then it's like, oh, but, you know, am I neglecting the
future? And I think, you know, that's one of the first things that people ask when they're new to unschooling, and they come on a group and they've got, you know, like a 3-year-old, and they're like, wow, will they be able to go to college? You know, like, wow, they're three. So yeah, and people do. It's a really huge thing that people see that college is, you know, it's set up there that there's no success without that path, and with unschooling, well, how are they going to go along that path? So I do think that my background has actually been a really good thing for both Brett and I to not worry about that, because we both went back to university as mature age students. So we know that there are many paths into college that are not necessarily, you know, straight through school, straight to college. I was 25 when I went back to college. Brett was 21. So, in terms of the idea of success being tied up to that idea of education through school and then straight into college, I think that we, as a family, have got a pretty unique perspective on that. I left school with no qualifications, and Brett did, he finished it. So it's the HSC here in Australia. Brett did get his HSC, but he really found high school hard and thought that he struggled and didn't do well. He is an interesting story as well. He as loved reptiles as long as he can remember. He's been running around catching lizards and snakes since he was around 8. Most of the snakes here in Australia are venomous, so that's a fun thing to do. I'm sure. Poor mother. But he was around, when he was around Kai's age, so around 9 or 10, his mom was worried that he wasn't reading the books that she thought that he should be reading, and she went and spoke to his English teacher and said, oh, he's reading is these books about lizards. And he's not proper, you know, War and Peace or something. But the teacher sounded like she was a very wise teacher, so he was lucky and told his mom, don't worry about that, you know, let him read the reptile box. If he's reading about things he loves, then he's going to be learning. So that was really cool. But he wanted to work with reptiles, and his parents were pretty working class as well. His dad was a plumber. And they told him that he probably couldn't really get a job working with reptiles because they didn't know anybody that worked with lizards. And so they said that, you know, you need to get a trade. That was what he was expected to do. It was back in the era where, women worked in offices and men got a trade. And that was what he was expected to do. But when he left school, he kind of floundered because he didn't really know what he wanted to do. He wanted to work with lizards and animals, but he didn't know how to go about that. But he went back to do a night course in being an animal technician, and it was there that he met a guy who said he was going to leave the course and study zoology and do a degree. And so that's how Brett ended up doing a degree. And he was 21 then. So he certainly went on a different road into university as well. The idea of getting into college is, I guess, because I did so badly at school. I shouldn't say that. I should say that school did badly by me. I just didn't do school the way that I didn't learn the way that people are supposed to in school, not in that linear way. I don't know, my thoughts are all over the place, I guess. So I've never really thought that school was the best road to college, because it wasn't for me. It took many years out of school for me to recover from the idea that I wasn't smart enough to go to university and college. All that traveling and you know, independence, it took, a decade nearly for me to feel like I could go back to university and to recover from all that. But getting back to your, feeling neglectful, even with our backgrounds, you still, and I guess being around academics, you get sucked into that idea and we both still, still need to de-school and move past that worry that we're letting Kai down or totally screwing him up, in the future, and he won't be able to go to college and do what he wants to do, even though we know that's not true.
It's still there.
I think, that worry, it really only it does fade with experience, and as you see kids do amazing things in unschooling and learn all these things, and you're like, wow, how did they learn that? But I mean, in the beginning you read about everybody else's kids. I read about your kids, Sandra's kids, and Joyce and Pam and Pam Sarushian, and you just keep reading those stories and go, wow, I hope they're not like special cases. Maybe I'm really gonna screw my kid up. He's still only 10, but over the years, I've watched him learn to read, he's learned to tell the time and make decisions and choices, and he's an amazing, kind, generous person. He's always the peacekeeper in his friends. He's very good at handling other people. And I know that he can do anything that he wants to do. And I think what's more important to me, because I came out of school so damaged, that he knows that he can do anything that he wants to do. He learned to read without being taught. Mm-hmm. He won't need 10 years to recover from the idea that he's stupid. He knows he can learn anything. And I think that's the most, that's self-confidence and self-awareness. And I think that's more important than anything to me, I think.
I think you're right. That you have to give it the time and the experience as in participating in unschooling, seeing your child, being with your child, spending time with them, because that is what's going to help you see that they don't need school or college to learn, that you just see them soaking up knowledge and understanding like a sponge and just being curious, right? Isn't it the curiosity? That's a huge piece for me, seeing that, they're asking questions and they're figuring things out and they don't need to be
now when he was younger, it was obviously I was more a part of bringing things into the house and books that can go on those knowledge trails where one thing led to something completely unrelated. You're like, how do we end up learning about this? But now he does that, he's on YouTube and one YouTube leads to another YouTube and then it leads to a new game and can I get this game? And then that game will lead to something else. And it's still happening. It's just, the curiosity is, wow, look at this and what about that? And it's amazing to see the things that he gets interested in and where that stems from. And that's the kind of thinking that doesn't serve schools very well. Maybe that's why I did so badly at school. My thinking was always all over the place. They were trying to teach me something about geography in India and I was more sitting there thinking about eating curry or making curry or something.
That's a great point. Yeah, exactly.
My mind was in a whole different part of India than they wanted me to learn.
But you can't
and
say,
I was lucky I got to travel around India eventually.
Oh, awesome. Surprise. Now, one of the things that I found really interesting when I think about it more is how differently the conventional focus on pursuing success. So it's like to be successful. And the unschooling focus on pursuing our personal goals, how they play out so differently. I was wondering if that's been your experience as well. And how is life different now that the conventional measures of, pursuing success on its own terms no longer play a key role?
Yeah, this was a really interesting question. And I've been thinking about this a lot, actually. I was thinking it was really hard to answer, but then I then it wasn't. I think that, I mean, and you would obviously know as well, like, unschooling is not just, it's not just about Kyle. Like, when you fully embrace radical unschooling, it affects everyone in the family, and even ripples out to family members who are even in school. You know, I've seen our choices have influenced, you know, family members to make different choices for their kids as well, which is really, like, it's just pervaded all of our lives. More and more, as Brett and I have de-schooled and watched Kai flourish in unschooling and following his passions. While we were both working in academia, you get fixated on this fictional idea of success, which seems to mostly involve, you know, in academia at least, you know, getting more grant money and making more publications, and eventually you'll get a tenured position, and you know, and that's it, success. Everything you like, fantastic once you get that tenured position, you know, because that's going to lead to financial security, and you'll get the house, and, you know, you'll be able to have a nice holiday somewhere exotic once or twice a year in the future, in your ideal successful future. But yeah, as I kind of touched on before, that idea of success didn't really turn out to be that great for us. And over the years, we've watched other people really get bogged down in the academic idea of success. And we watch friends burn out and get depression and get divorced. And it's just a really stressful environment. It's very competitive. And I don't think that that's just academia. I think it's a lot of those kinds of careers. You just end up, you know, working lots and lots of hours, and there's no time for anything else, to focus on anything else. It was kind of a relief when I decided I didn't want to pursue academia anymore, and then Brett decided a little time later, after another 4-year postdoc in Adelaide. And we both still love and passionate about science and animals, and we always will be, but we know we can pursue that in a different way outside of academia, where we're not sucked into this stressful environment. Back to unschooling permeating all of our lives. Brett is really passionate about fly fishing. Very passionate. Brett's a perfectionist. A little bit OCD, you might say. And he practices his fly casting every day, runs back from work, and he goes to the school oval and he practices his casting. And I feel like before unschooling, I would probably have just thought that was at best an annoying hobby, because it takes up a lot of his time. He's very focused on it. There's about 20 fishing rods at least under the bed. But I feel like learning to support Kai and his passions has meant that I'm getting better. I'm not perfect, but I'm getting better at supporting Brett in his passions and in fly fishing too. And it's, I guess, getting away from that idea of success. And, you know, Brett's fly fishing is never going to bring in much money. Probably the opposite, looking at those 20 fly fishing rods. But as a family, we're trying to support him as much as we can to be successful, and it's successful in the way that he wants to be successful. In that he wants to be really good at it, and he's going to take his certified casting instructor test in a few weeks in Sydney. So we're all going as a family to cheer him on. Hopefully he'll get a pass that. I'm pretty sure he will.
Very cool.
Yeah, so I do think that, back to your question. How is life different that conventional measures of success no longer play a key role? I think life is way less stressful, that we're not bogged down in worrying about this future that is supposedly so important. We manage with less money. I mean, we're still luckier than a lot of people. You know, we have a house and stuff and food. So, you know, we're not rich, but, you know, we're certainly not terribly poor either. And I think now we don't worry about conventional measures of success. You're so much more grateful for everything you've got right now, in this moment. You're not always thinking in the future. I think that's probably one of the most different things now for us.
That's a great point.
We shifted where your focus is
from that pursuit to that, you know, that carrot that's always out there in the future, actually, you know, being in the moment, looking at today.
Yeah, exactly. And we only rent a little house, but it's big enough for the three of us. There's only three of us, and we live in a very cool little town and with lots of awesome coffee shops, which is and you know, and we maybe we'll never own our own house, I don't know, but you know, that has meant for us that we've been free to travel around and move whenever we wanted to without the added stresses of buying and selling a house. You know, that's been a positive too. I think I've been really lucky since I left academia that I work from home, writing about science and climate change mostly. And now Kai's a little bit older. I recently took a temporary job doing some field work, which has been interesting as a 46-year-old. I've been out putting out wildlife cameras for a local endangered species, the leadbeater's possum. And so that's been really cool. It's more back to what I really wanted to do when I first got into zoology. I'm not saving whales, but maybe I'm saving some leadbeater's possums. So, Kai, I don't know what he'll choose to do. He has expressed an interest in zoology, which is quite interesting because I can't believe we haven't put him off already. The poor child's been out catching lizards on field trips since he was like two. So. he might go to college, he might not, he might choose to pursue that in a different way. I guess that, as we were saying, the conventional measure of success is so focused on an ideal future. One day if you work hard at school and then you work hard at college, you'll have a good job and a money and a house. But it means that you miss this living in the moment and appreciating everything you've got right now. You're always focused on this endpoint that, you know, that may or may not come. You just don't know that. When I was thinking about this question, I was thinking that in the end it kind of related back to why I don't like calling Kai's current moment a cocoon phase. Because, again, the problem with thinking of it as a cocoon phase is that it implies we're all putting up with this cocoon phase waiting for him to come out as a butterfly and everything's going to be okay then at some point in the future. And I feel like that's the same as what's wrong with the idea of conventional success. You're always looking down the road waiting for some kind of ideal in the future and missing what's happening right now. That was what I thought about when I thought about it a lot.
I think that is such a great point, because, and you mentioned a little bit earlier, the gratitude for the moment, because when you, so much of I think of what you're kind of looking for down the road actually is right in front of you in the moment. If you, you know, look at it with a little bit wider perspective, there's so much good stuff here now if you look for it, rather than wishing you had something else further.
I mean people even miss, you know, you rush through school and you know, most people have rushed into college at 18 or whatever, and all those kids that are 18 are focused on is finishing college. You know, they're not even enjoying being there at that time. And I've got some of my family, they kind of got pushed into college. They're in their 20s now, but you know, they end up choosing a major that they're not even really that interested in, and they don't really, I mean, there's not a rare few people know exactly what they want to do with the rest of their lives when they're 18. So forcing a kid to choose what they want to study at college at 18 is, I don't know, that's one of the crazier things in life, I think.
it's forcing them to try and look down the road again. It just keeps your eye on the future,
Exactly. You just come out of being spoon-fed in school and then you're expected to know what you want to do for the rest of your life and go to college for 3 or 4 years and study that. And, it's kind of wacky when you think about it.
A little bit.
Yeah, it's, you know, and yeah, and those kids are always focused on the future, wishing away those college years, going, oh, God, you know, I'm here for another 3 or 4 years and then I get my degree and then life can start then, you know, and I'll be a success.
Yeah.
Yeah.
True. I remember that.
I guess going back to the pure age student and university being a choice for me rather than being herded into it, I had a very different experience, and I really loved going to university and I loved all my lectures, well, except chemistry. I'm not good at chemistry. You're probably much better at chemistry, Pam.
I did do that.
Yeah. And my PhD, I mean, lots of people were in PhDs and didn't really want to even be doing them, you know, and they were just doing them because they, you know, their parents had said, yeah, you have to get a doctorate and then you'll be a success. And they was kind of slogging through that 3 years of their PhD, and I was having a blast.
Yeah.
I was running around on a tropical island with possums on my head. And yeah, it was.
That's so cool. That kind of, yeah, go ahead.
No, I just, yeah, it just seemed like a very different, I had a very different experience, I think, going through college and doing my PhD as a choice rather than feeling like it was something I had to do to get to a point in, of success.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting because it seems like that's actually kind of led us right to the next question, which is just kind of a shift from there, because that conventional path and school has trained people to believe that work and when kids go to school, that's presented like as their work, right? You have to go to school. That's your job. My job is that job over there, and you're a kid, so your job is school. And train them to think it's not fun, right? It's just something they have to do. Like you were talking about, you know, the other kids weren't enjoying themselves. They were there for their work. I got to do this for the 3 years. And then your fun is your weekends, right? You get your weekends off. I remember a point when I looked in the dictionary and I saw work and fun, they actually, you know, were listed as antonyms, opposites of each other.
Yeah.
I think unschooling turns that idea totally on its head. So I was just wondering if you could speak to that. I expect that's been your experience as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. In everything, I guess. And I think the big thing about work and fun being opposites is lack of choice, I guess. I think that, yeah, getting back to what I was just saying earlier, I made the choice to go to university. I was already doing cool, fun stuff. I was traveling all over the world, you know, and I made the choice to stop doing that and because I really wanted to be a zoologist, and that was my choice. And so it never felt, I mean, it was work. Of course I worked really hard, but it never felt like it was the opposite of fun. So, you know, like catching possums on a tropical island is pretty fun. Even, you know, it was more work when there was mosquitoes. But and I think that idea is really almost, yeah, just comes down to feeling like you have a choice. Kids in school don't have a choice whether they go. You know, they don't even have a choice what time they get up in the morning and go to school. They certainly don't have a choice in what they get taught at any given moment. And that makes you feel really powerless. And everything feels like work, and definitely the opposite of fun. You know, if you're in school at 10 o'clock in the morning and you've got a math lesson, well, you've got to learn maths whether you like it or not. And 11 o'clock, if you move on to art, well, that's what you're going to learn at 11 o'clock. And it didn't matter if you loved maths and wanted to carry on with that. And it didn't matter if you wished you'd been doing art for the whole 2 hours. You don't have a choice. So, that's not fun. I remember school not being fun. It's not fun to do something that you haven't really chosen to do, I guess. In unschooling, that it just doesn't happen. You know, I watch Kai and his friends Skyping. Well, actually, I listen to it mostly. I don't watch them. But I can hear them, you know, and they're learning from following their passions is completely different. It's a completely different experience than watching a child trudge through school miserably, or even kids that kind of like school for the most part. There's still there times where they're being taught things that they don't have any interest in. And that's got to feel like work for sure. In unschooling, that doesn't happen because there's a choice. So, yeah, learning is a side effect of fun, I guess. And I guess, I don't know, I was thinking, is that learning work? I was trying to decide what I thought about that. I mean, yeah, sometimes it doesn't, like Kai's working really hard and he's researching something. You know, he wants to master one of the games that he's playing, and he'll do a lot of research and he'll go looking for walkthroughs and tips and you know, YouTube and gaming sites. And he and his friends discuss their strategy and how they can work best as a team and who's going to play which character, because they're all better at playing different characters in Overwatch. And so I guess that, yeah, that it kind of is work, but it's really play, I think.
Yeah.
And it's definitely fun.
It's definitely fun. But, yeah, that's something I see is, or you know, from comments and stuff, people think if they're choosing what they're doing, so, you know, they get to play all the time, they think, well, then they're just going to, like, take the easy way out. They don't realize the fun of, you know, the determination for pursuing things, like how much energy and effort that when it's your choice, you will put into getting to whatever goal you set for yourself or whatever you're trying to do. They don't realize that they will put all that work into it, but you know, because you're pursuing something that you want to do, it did you're concentrating and you're working hard, but it doesn't feel, because our definition of work is so negative, right? Opposite of play.
The opposite of fun.
It's just amazing. I think that's something that most people don't understand until they actually see some unschooling in action. Because
I think, of course,
kids at school are going to choose not to do the hard stuff when they can.
Well, yeah, because they're being forced to do hard stuff for stuff they're not interested in.
That's why it's hard.
I mean, it's there's been times where I think that I guess I don't want to call it work, but that determination, you know, to research something and follow a path where you're really trying to become good at something or find out something. That part of unschooling, when parents aren't fully de-schooled or they're not completely on board, I think they miss that part because it might be something that they're not valuing. So like video games, for example. Yeah. So They're missing that, though. They go, oh, all he's doing is watching YouTubes on video games. But, like, there's some hard work going on there.
Yeah.
You know? And, I mean, Kaya's actually started games from the beginning again. So Terraria comes to mind, and it was about a year ago. And he said, can you reinstall Terraria on the iPad? And I said, well, you lose all your stuff. Like, you're going to lose everything that you've got. And he said, oh, but most of that was given to me by my friends and I don't feel like I earned it myself. I want to go back and do it all by myself. And I was like, wow, that's crazy. and, I guess he sort of felt like he cheated somehow and he really wanted to go back and do all that by himself. And I just thought that was really incredible. And often I guess you would have certainly had those questions, you know, like how will they learn to, you know, follow through, or you know, if they can always take the easy way out, but they don't always take the easy way out. You know, if something's really important to them, they'll put in the hard yards to find out all about it and do all that research. So,
it's always fun to watch them, isn't it? It's just amazing.
Yeah, and back to your question about work and fun. I was thinking about our dog walking business, and so Kai is actually legitimately working at the moment. Yeah. Like a real job. He tells his friends on Skype, I've got to go out now and walk a dog for my dog walking business. So, it's still fun. Like he's not looking at it as work, and I don't, and I'm not getting the money. So, you know, it's super fun. We get to walk around. And yesterday, it's spring here, obviously, and everything's blossoming and there was beautiful flowers everywhere, and we spotted some carnivorous plants, and the dogs were always really happy to see us. So even that work is not really, it doesn't seem like work to us. It's mm-hmm. It's super fun. And he's learning so much from doing it too. He's starting to be able to see, you know, being around dogs and you can read their behavior. And so he's learning about behavior, animal behavior, and mm-hmm. He's very on top of managing his cash that he gets from it. And it's been interesting because he plays on Steam a lot. And so when you want to buy a gaming Steam, it's in US dollars. And so he's been going off into Google and working out the exchange rate, and then comes back in with his cash and pays me the right money in Australian dollars, because the Steam money goes off on my credit card. So, mm-hmm. so it's that's super fun. So, it's not work.
I know, it's not work. And there's so much learning in there.
Just sort of walking around in the sunshine with dogs, you know?
That's awesome. Speaking of it being spring there, as the trees are turning color here for fall.
Yes.
I was wondering if you could share with us a quick overview of what it's like to unschool in Australia. Maybe a little bit about the legalities and if there's local communities. I suspect you, your different territories are probably like our provinces, that they have some different, I guess they're not really laws. I hear they're regulated by the provincial departments of education.
In Australia, we've got states and territories. We've only got two territories, the rest of the states. It's very confusing. And each state and territory, in terms of homeschooling legalities, they differ, like in Canada and North America. We live in the state of Victoria right now. That's where Melbourne is. And Victoria is the easiest state to homeschooling. It's very easy. You just sign a statutory declaration every year and you're done. That's it.
That's what it is here too.
Other states have variations on a yearly report. So some states you get a home visit. So when we lived in Adelaide, we got a home visit every year from someone from the education department. And I wrote a report and they'd come and talk about that. And it was never really, it wasn't terrible, but other states you have to send in work samples, which is a bit of a hoop to jump for unschoolers, but people manage. So it's possible certainly to unschool in every state and territory in Australia. There are different hoops to jump through, but it's definitely possible. A lot, yeah, communities. In Melbourne here, we have got quite a few unschoolers, which is really awesome. And we can meet face-to-face. We go to Park Day. I'm also incredibly grateful that all of our kids are around the same age, which is really great. So they're all tweens. We've all got sort of 10, 11, 12-year-olds, which is super fun. Elsewhere, I guess because we've travelled around so much, I haven't met quite a lot. I've kind of taken it upon myself to try and meet as many unschoolers that I know online in real life if I can. So there are small groups of unschoolers in Sydney and Brisbane, so mostly the bigger cities, so the cities that mm-hmm. people will have heard about. But because Australia's so huge and spread out, lots of people do live in isolated areas. And there are also lots of conventional homeschoolers too here, especially out in the bush, less by choice, I think, people homeschool out there. There are just no schools out there. So I'm sure there are places like that in Canada as well. we are all spread out. Melbourne's definitely got the biggest number of unschoolers, I guess. So, but we have a very active online community, which is super cool. And so we all kind of know each other from that. And Sandra Dodd came in 2014 to do the Always Learning Live symposium. Mm-hmm. And so I organised one in Adelaide, and we also drove Sandra on a road trip to Melbourne, and we came to the Melbourne one as well. And that was really cool because all of the people that we knew online, most of them came to see Sandra somewhere. So we got to meet in real life, which, you know, I love online, but it is super cool to meet people in real life as well. And our kids got to hang out, so that was very cool. So that's, I guess, in a nutshell, unschooling in Australia. Mm-hmm. There's not as many of us as there is in North America. But one thing we are lacking is definitely conferences. So, I'm always very jealous when I see all of the conferences going on in Canada and America. and then people keep telling me I should just organise one, but, yeah.
soon, yeah, get in touch. Well, that was awesome. Thanks for the picture there. I always find it interesting to see how it goes. There are definitely some similarities. And, I mean, here, too, my connections were mostly online for many years before I found, you know, then I decided to host a conference so that I could find local people. That's what I did.
We need to all get together. We should do it. Maybe.
Yeah. There you go.
I'm a bit older and I've got a bit more time.
Yeah. Well, I want to say thanks so much for taking the time to speak with me, Jill. That was so much fun. Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. It's been super fun. I can't believe an hour has gone away already.
I know. It just went zooming by. And before we go, where's the best place for people to connect with you online?
On Facebook. So I'm on Facebook. I'm just Joe Isaac. And at the moment, I write mostly it's a new group called Unschooling Q&A. It's a super fun group that I just started with some online friends from America. And, that's where I'm writing and answering questions most of the time. I do have a blog, but it's much neglected and best not to go there.
Oh, great. Well, I'll make sure I get the right links and I will share them in the show notes for everybody. Great. Thanks again. Say good morning to Kai and have a wonderful day.
I will, thanks.
Thanks for listening. I hope you found it helpful. You might also like the backlist episodes at livingjoyfully.ca/podcast. And if you'd like to immerse yourself in unschooling ideas and inspiration with a group of like-minded parents, check out childhoodredefine.com for information about the Childhood Redefined Unschooling Summit. It's being held in Bethany Beach, Delaware, October 19th to the 21st, hosted by me and Ann Oman. Registration is now open until September 16th. Have a great day!